What is truth when applied to science? Can we prove scientific theory to be true? These are just two of the questions I wish to discuss, and I hope to provide you some insight into the difficulties associated with the word truth when related to scientific study and experimentation. Whilst I'd like to thank Mr. Miller for inviting me to talk on the subject of truth, I'm afraid I have to start this talk on a sour note. Unfortunately, due to the empirical nature of science, there is no such thing as scientific proof. Nothing is final. All scientific knowledge is only tentative, provisional. For a theorem to be proven, it must be forever true. This cannot be the case in science, and as such, the currently accepted theory is just the one where there is more compelling and credible evidence. It will remain the accepted theory until a better theory or new evidence comes along. Nature is not binary or logical, and as such, truth in science is unfortunately an impossible dream. Now, having said that, scientific knowledge, and as such, the current truth, is an extremely important discussion point. How do we reach these theories? And what do we require as evidence to back them up? For the ease of this talk, I will refer to the truth as the most current and accepted theories in science. Now, I'd like to take you on a brief thought experiment, a walk through your imagination. I want you to imagine that you're attending a sports match. The game has already begun. Now pause there for a second, and your view would look something like you can see on the screen now. Now I want you to imagine the pitch, and the players, but most importantly the ball. Now, where is the ball? At what position on the field is the ball currently placed? For ease, and the pedants, let's state that the ball must be in the field of play. However, you have no way of knowing where on the pitch it currently stands. On the contrary, you know that it could feasibly be in any part of the pitch, any position. The argument therefore follows that until you have observed the ball and as such stated its unique classical position, probability dictates where it is most likely to be found. We therefore state the ball is, until observed, currently located in all the possible positions about the pitch. This is known as a superposition and one of the pillars of quantum mechanics. This is no doubt a very basic and crude analogy of what is an extremely complex phenomenon, a phenomenon associated with the particular properties, specifically wave-particle duality, of subatomic particles, particles within atoms such as electrons. However, I feel it very important discussion point when related to the idea of truth as applied to science. How could we suggest a theory on subatomic particles to be true if we cannot observe them, and as such do not know their finite position, as is the case with an electron? What do we require for evidence? Erwin Schrödinger's thought experiment in 1935 involving a cat in a box, on which the football analogy was reproduced, was intended to ridicule the existing theories on quantum mechanics. Theories that stated subatomic particles could be in two or more positions at one time. Theories that have since been shown to accurately represent the quantum model. In the case of quantum mechanics, compelling direct evidence, and as such the truth, is extremely challenging. No subatomic particle can be directly observed, and as such, how can we know they exist? What can we use to interpret their existence? Well, the arguments surrounding quantum mechanics will continue to rage for generations to come. However, I believe it does raise an important question. Are we prepared to believe something to be true based solely on the indirect evidence of its existence, as is the case with the subatomic world? Let me put it another way. If I showed you a puddle and told you that it had rained, would you believe me? Is that the truth? Could it not be the case that it has snowed and melted, or produced from a hose pipe? And further, is it important to know the truth? Why can you just not take my word for it that it has rained? Or that the electron exists, as J.J. Thompson suggested, by measuring the radiated energy? Well, in 1998, a scientist by the name of Andrew Wakefield produced a paper about 12 children linking the administration of the MMR vaccine with autism. This paper was since found to have been dishonest, fraudulent, and based on no scientific truth. However, due to intense media coverage, so-called fake news, the research has been blamed for a significant drop in vaccination rates over the past two decades. In the UK in 1998, there were 56 measles cases. By 2008, there were 1,348 cases with two confirmed deaths. In 2016, this number has fallen. However, there is still belief in some quarters of this pseudoscience, resulting in a continued lower than desired level of vaccination. Pseudoscience includes beliefs, theories, or practices that have been or are considered scientific, but have no basis in scientific fact. This can mean they were disproved scientifically, can't be tested, or lack evidence to support them. And as shown with Dr. Wakefield, can be extremely dangerous. One only needs to consider thalidomide and the damage done to thousands of unborn embryos to see the importance of truth when applied to scientific and particularly pharmaceutical studies. I would suggest that unlike other disciplines, fake science is a major and increasing threat to public health. As the appetite for consumers for better, faster, stronger drugs continues to grow, we must ensure that our scientific theories are based on the strongest foundations of knowledge and truth. In summation, scientific truth is never final. As our technical ability to observe reality improves, we are able to increase the quality and quantity of our experiments and observations. Better observed data challenges our explanations, some of which will no longer fit the observed facts. New theories are then formed and either verified or falsified. What we base this verification process on is crucial. The more comprehensive and conclusive our evidence can be, the better. And yes, when no other alternatives are possible, I believe indirect evidence is a sound basis of theory. And as scientists, we must be scrupulous in our analysis of these theories, as we have seen all too regularly the harm that can come when corners are cut in the search for truth in science. The joy of the discipline is that I can confidently state that scientific fact, currently regarded as truth, will continue to be disproved for generations to come.